Good evening. Good evening, everyone. I'm Jennifer Rabb and have the extraordinary privilege of being the president of the wonderful Hunter College. It is a great pleasure to welcome you all to our third event in our Winston Churchill Literary Series. This series is dedicated to exploring the life and legacy of one of the 20th century's towering figures. Hunter takes special pride in helping to make the programs possible because as stewards of this beautiful townhouse in which we are now gathered, we are keepers of the legacy of another giant of that era, Franklin Roosevelt. Roosevelt House was Franklin and Eleanor's home from 1908 until they moved to the White House in 1933. It was here that they raised their children, here that FDR recovered from polio, and here that he launched his campaigns for governor and president. This house served as his transition headquarters and was the place that the ideas behind the New Deal were born. This is then an ideal setting for considering the lessons that Sir Winston Churchill can teach us, as well as recalling the leadership and the friendship he shared with Franklin Roosevelt. I especially love the account of Churchill's first visit to the White House in the early days of World War II. After settling into the Rose bedroom, he called in FDR's butler and laid down his rules as follows. One, I don't like talking outside my quarters. Two, I hate whistling in the corridors. And three, I must have a tumbler of sherry in my room before breakfast, a couple of glasses of scotch and soda before lunch, and French champagne and well-aged brandy before I go to sleep at night. As the chief of the Secret Service later said, never before had the White House seen anyone quite like Sir Winston. This evening, we are going to hear from a major historian of that era, Lynne Olson. Lynne's achievements are so significant. In fact, former Secretary of State Madeleine Albright has called her, quote, our era's foremost chronicler of World War II politics and diplomacy. Albright offered that praise following the publication of Lynne's best-selling book, Citizens of London, about three Americans who were early supporters of Churchill and helped persuade the U.S. to aid the British. That book followed Lynne's previous triumph, Troublesome Young Men, which told the story of how a small band of rebels in Parliament fought to bring Churchill to power and save England. This evening, we are privileged that Lynne will be talking about her newest book, Those Angry Days, about the debate in America over intervention in the war. We know it will be a fascinating discussion. Roosevelt House is co-presenting this program with the Hunter Writing Center, which under the leadership of Louis Frumkus has become a leader in the teaching of writing, literature, and culture. And I just want to take a moment for all of us to acknowledge Louis Frumkus. And then, of course, we are so deeply grateful for the entire Churchill series, whose work is supported and really was the brainchild of our own Tina Santi Flaherty. At Hunter, we know and love Tina not only for her support of this program, but also her innovative ideas and support for the wonderful Irish Voices literary series. Tina herself is an award-winning author and journalist. She has been a pioneer for women in the highest levels in the business world and is well known among the city's top philanthropists. I am so proud personally to call her a colleague and a friend. And I must say, when Tina approached us as having a series on Churchill for over a number of years, we had a little bit of trepidation. Would people really come three times a year to hear about Winston Churchill? Standing room only, crowds pouring out, and a number of people, Tina, who are still a little angry they didn't get a seat tonight. So I am never so happy about being so wrong. And of course, it's wonderful to have Tina in this house where Eleanor Roosevelt's spirit still informs us in these wonderful pictures of Eleanor, because Tina herself lives in Jackie Kennedy Onassis's apartment building, and more importantly, has written a wonderful book about Jackie O and the lessons of her life, which I am so pleased to report is about to be released. Tina, thank you so much for all that you do for New York City to make us so much better informed and really truly educated citizens. It is a great pleasure to have you in the Hunter family and to welcome you tonight. Tina Flaherty.
Thank you, Jennifer, for that wonderful introduction. I never want anyone but Jennifer to introduce me. Thank you so much. Also, I want to thank all of you for coming tonight, because I know in a city like New York, we've got a lot of choices. So we're just honored that you're here. But I have to say, I definitely think you made the right choice when you chose to come and hear Lynne Olson and her beautiful prose that was revealed in her book, Citizens of London. A few words about the Churchill series. As you know, it wouldn't have been possible without the gracious sponsorship of all the people I work with, like Jennifer Rabb, the president of Hunter College, the fabulous Faye Rosenfeld, who runs the Hunter College Public Policy Institute, and Louis Frumkes and all his wit and wisdom, who at first didn't agree with me about the Churchill series, but I persevered, as usual. So at the very beginning of my brief remarks, I'm going to tell you a hard truth. And the truth is that so many of you ask me, why do you want to sponsor a Churchill series? I never had a hero before in my life until I even felt like I met Winston Churchill until I had Winston Churchill. He's my man. He's definitely my man for all seasons and all reasons. And it's definitely my honor and privilege to extend and perpetuate his legacy in any manner that's appropriate. And speaking of heroes, who better than Lynne Olson to speak about the heroic efforts of Winston Churchill, as well as those of President Franklin Delano Roosevelt during those early days of World War II. Most of you have probably, if you've read any of Lynne's books, you've discovered what I discovered for yourself. Reading one of Lynne's books is a little like eating potato chips. You just can't stop with one. One author said, "This woman is incapable of writing a boring sentence. I would follow her anywhere." So that was a wonderful tribute. And you know about her previous book, which was just absolutely fabulous, Citizens of London. It was named the top best-selling book of 2010 by the American Library Association, and it shed important new light on the special relationship that Churchill and Roosevelt had. I really couldn't put this book down, and it was so beautifully written that I was moved to tears at special passages. I don't know if you know that Churchill described himself as a blubberer because he cried easily. Well, I cried easily during your book because it was just so touching and such a read. After reading it, I went out and bought 6 copies, including one for my ex-husband. So, greater love hath no woman for one of her favorite authors than that demonstration. But Lynne's latest book, Those Angry Days, is an equally compelling account of World War II and makes a fine bookend to Citizens of London. Not only did Madeleine Albright say wonderful things about your book, as did Tom Brokaw, but also the Associated Press. Their reviews said, "Those Angry Days, journalist turned historian Lynne Olson captures that period in a fast-moving, highly readable narrative punctuated by high drama. It's an ideal complement to her previous books." I really need to say no more, but I can't help but saying, I have heard Lynne speak before, and you're really in for a treat because she is as fabulous a speaker as she is writer. So Lynne, the stage is all yours.
Wow, the bar is raised pretty high. There's so many people I have to thank here. President Jennifer Rabb, thank you so much. Tina, you are the godmother of all this. You've been so generous in supporting this lecture series. Thanks. And everyone here at Roosevelt House, especially Faye Rosenfeld, who I've been communicating back and forth with, Louis Frumkes of the Writing Center. I can't tell you how delighted I am to be here tonight, and I thank all of you so much for coming. Reading glasses, just started wearing them. I'd like to start tonight by reading a quotation from Winston Churchill, which is, "You can always count on the Americans to do the right thing after they've tried everything else." It's a wonderfully funny line, typically Churchillian, but there are a lot of emotions behind it, exasperation, anger, and bitterness among them. Churchill clearly felt all those emotions in the desperate days of 1940 and 1941, when he and his country were the last ones in Europe standing against Hitler. The British had been bombed night after night by the Luftwaffe, while German submarines operated at will in the Atlantic, sinking vast amounts of merchant shipping headed for Britain and slowly strangling British supply lines. This tiny island was very close to defeat. In the words of Field Marshal Lord Allenbrooke, Britain's top military leader during the war, we were hanging on by our eyelids. The United States, meanwhile, the only country that could save Britain, was sitting on the sidelines, debating and debating and debating what to do. Several of my earlier books, as Tina has said, have touched on this period, but they've been written primarily from the point of view of Churchill and the British, and in Citizens of London, from the viewpoint of several Americans who were doing their best to help save Britain. In this latest book, Those Angry Days, I decided to take a look at what was going on in the United States during the years 1939 to 1941. What I found was an extraordinary story, one that I realized I didn't know very much about, and one that I don't think most people do. Now, you know, historians have discussed the issues of isolationism and interventionism in great detail, but they've tended to focus on questions of policy. Most of them have not really looked at the human story of the time, the ferociousness of this fight, the nail-biting suspense over whether Britain would in fact be saved, the extreme polarization in this country, not unlike today, that tore apart friendships and ripped apart families. The passions back then were at fever pitch. Eric Severide, who was a young CBS correspondent at the time, called the period bitter and heartburning. Arthur Schlesinger Jr., who as a 20-something graduate student was caught up in this struggle, called it the most savage political debate in my lifetime. In his autobiography, Schlesinger wrote, "Though historians have dealt with the policy issues, justice has not been done to the searing personal impact of those angry days." And as you probably have guessed, I took the title of the book from that Schlesinger quote. During these 2 years that I write about, what was then called the Great Debate raged throughout the nation, from the White House and Congress to bars, beauty parlors, offices, and classrooms, in the biggest of cities and the smallest of towns. Millions of people, from college students to housewives to Wall Street lawyers, were caught up in this struggle, knowing that whatever its outcome, their lives were likely to be profoundly affected. At stake was not only the survival of Britain, but also the shape and future of America. What was the US to be? A fortress country that refused to break out of its isolationist shell, still believing it must be free of foreign commitments? Those who believed that argued we must be ready to fight for the defense of our own nation, but for nothing and no one else. On the other hand, those who supported intervention said we could no longer evade international responsibility. The times were too dangerous. Britain's survival was absolutely essential for our own security and welfare, they said. They argued that if the British were defeated and Hitler controlled all of Europe, he would move to dominate Africa and infiltrate South America, which would then pose a serious threat to the US. We would have little chance to survive as a free and democratic society. Others in the interventionist camp emphasized what they saw as America's moral obligation to stop Hitler, the embodiment, as they saw it, of pure evil. How could we stand on the sidelines, they argued, while Nazi Germany conquered sovereign countries, went on a rampage against Jews, and threatened to wipe out Western civilization as we know it? At the center of the debate were the two most famous men in America, President Franklin D. Roosevelt and Charles Lindbergh, the young man who mesmerized the world in 1927 when he flew alone across the Atlantic. FDR wanted America to come to the aid of Britain, while Lindbergh, who became the unofficial leader and spokesman for the country's isolationists, believed that the United States must stay clear of the war and focus solely on its own defense. Because of who these men were, they both had a huge impact on public opinion. Actually, the two of them already had a history. 5 years before, just a year after Roosevelt had taken office, Lindbergh had challenged FDR's cancellation of airmail delivery contracts that had been granted to the country's largest airlines by FDR's Republican predecessor, Herbert Hoover. Roosevelt said there had been fraud and bribery involved in giving out the contracts, and he ordered the U.S. Army Air Corps, which was the predecessor to the Air Force, to start delivering the mail. Lindbergh was an advisor to one of those airlines, and he publicly criticized FDR for ending the contracts without giving the companies a chance to respond. He also warned that Air Corps flyers didn't have the experience and the right type of instruments in their planes to take on this incredibly hazardous job, which involved flying in all extremes of weather, blizzards, thunderstorms, etc. Now remember, Lindbergh had been an airmail pilot, so he knew what he was talking about, and he turned out to be right. In the 4 months that Army pilots flew the mail, there were 12 men killed, 66 crashes, and as one writer put it, untold humiliation for the Air Corps and the White House. Very soon, the airlines were back delivering the mail. This was Roosevelt's first major public relations defeat, and he never forgave Lindbergh for that. And I personally think that the bad feelings left over from that earlier conflict between both of them were part of the reason for the extremely bitter confrontation between them in the years I write about. One of the things that really surprised me when I was doing research for the book was how brutal this debate was for everyone. FDR said it was going to be a dirty fight, and it turned out to be that. The president was convinced that the isolationists, particularly Lindbergh, posed a major threat to the country and himself. And he and his supporters embarked on a campaign to damage their credibility, influence, and reputations, calling them, among other things, subversives, fifth columnists, and even Nazis. In addition, FDR allowed a covert British intelligence organization to operate in America, actually out of the building in Rockefeller Center that's directly opposite St. Patrick's Cathedral on Fifth Avenue, just a few blocks from here, the International Building. This operation had the bland, innocuous title of the British Security Coordination, and its main job was to get America into the war, no matter how. It carried on its own kind of dirty tricks campaign, spying on anti-war groups, digging up political dirt on congressional isolationists, wiretapping phones of unfriendly diplomats in Washington, meaning German, Italian, Vichy French, Japanese, planning propaganda in US newspapers, and even forging documents. We were a neutral country at that point still, so of course all of this was more than slightly illegal. I hasten to add that Lindbergh and the other prominent isolationists were not blameless in this fight, although they were not nearly as good at it as the interventionist side. They portrayed FDR as a dictator, much along the same lines as Hitler and Mussolini, and they claimed he was responsible for destroying free speech in America and rushing it into war without the people's consent. During those 2 years, Washington, again like today, was a real snake pit filled with intrigue and infighting. Just to give you one example, there were a number of high-ranking officers in the Army, Navy, and Air Corps who were doing their best to sabotage the policies of FDR, who was, after all, their commander-in-chief. Many of them were isolationists. Now, that really surprised me. I mean, maybe I'm naive, but I usually think there's a fair amount of militarism in the military services. But that wasn't true, at least on the part of a number of, as I said, high-ranking official military leaders. Among them was an Army colonel named Truman Smith, who was General George Marshall's chief advisor on Germany, and at the same time was one of Lindbergh's closest friends, and was actively working with Lindbergh in the isolationist cause. He and several other top officers were leaking top secret information to Lindbergh and to isolationist members of Congress. The biggest leaker of all turned out to be none other than General Hap Arnold, the Air Corps Chief of Staff, who just before Pearl Harbor was implicated in the leak of one of the administration's most closely guarded military secrets, a contingency plan for all-out war against Germany. This bitter polarization that existed in Washington was echoed all throughout the country. In those angry days, I write a lot about Charles Lindbergh's wife, Anne, one of the most interesting people I've ever really written about, who was caught right up in the middle of this very nasty fight. Anne Morrow Lindbergh was the daughter of Dwight Morrow, a former J.P. Morgan partner, who then became a U.S. ambassador, and after that, a U.S. senator. Anne Lindbergh had grown up as part of the East Coast establishment, which tended to be pro-British and interventionist. Because she supported her husband in his isolationism, although not really ever convinced, I don't think, that it was the right thing to do, she found herself estranged from virtually all her old friends and acquaintances, all the people she had grown up with, who looked on Lindbergh, in her words, as the Antichrist. All of this took an enormous emotional toll on her. What was particularly painful for Anne was the split within her own family. Her mother was a leading activist for interventionism, and her sister Constance, who was really Anne's best friend, worked with her husband, a Brit named Aubrey Morgan, who became one of the top propagandists for the British government in America. Morgan's job was to do everything he could to get the US into the war, which was the very thing Charles Lindbergh was trying to prevent. FDR was caught in the middle too, between interventionists who wanted him to do more than he had been doing for England, and isolationists who wanted to focus on the US. For all of his first term and much of his second, Roosevelt had been focused on domestic issues, not surprisingly, and incredibly brilliantly, because his main job then was to try to get us out of the Depression. He had stayed away pretty much from foreign policy issues. As a result, he hadn't really educated the public that we might have to get involved somehow in stopping Hitler. When we think of FDR now, we think, of course, of his bold, brilliant leadership in the first years of his presidency in particular, and then again after America entered the war. But during those critical years, 39 to 41, while he was forceful in his repeated calls for action to help Britain and end German aggression, he occasionally procrastinated in making such action a reality. You have to remember, it was a very difficult time for him, politically and personally. Just less than 2 years before, he had suffered the two worst political defeats of his presidency. He'd been humiliated by Congress in his effort to pack the Supreme Court, and then humiliated by voters in his unsuccessful effort to purge some of his conservative Democratic opponents, congressional opponents, in the 1938 election. It was probably the lowest point of his presidency, and it coincided with the period in which Hitler and Mussolini stepped up their march to war. And I think that he temporarily lost his confidence that once had been absolute, that the American people would always stand behind him for those in those 2 years. From then on until Pearl Harbor, he tended to exaggerate the power of congressional isolationists and was quite reluctant to challenge them. But the important thing to remember is that he did not mind being pushed by others to do more. And they did. Throughout this period, he was urged on by several private citizens groups, which mounted campaigns to educate and mobilize American public opinion in favor of intervention. The work of these organizations, according to one prominent interventionist, allowed Roosevelt to move gingerly in the direction of saving his sleeping country. Interventionist groups played a critical role in the administration's decision to send 50 old destroyers to Britain, which was a very controversial move at the time. They also helped persuade Roosevelt to make important changes in his cabinet, and they were the chief force in convincing a highly skeptical FDR and Congress to approve the first peacetime draft in the summer of 1940, an extremely controversial step to take in the midst of a presidential campaign. 2 months after the draft bill was passed, a coalition of political amateurs hijacked the largely isolationist Republican Party, and at one of the most exciting conventions in American history, engineered the presidential nomination of Wendell Willkie, a former businessman who had announced his candidacy only 7 weeks before. If there's a hero in my book, it's Wendell Willkie. He was a strong interventionist, unlike most of the regulars in the Republican Party. And he supported much of FDR's foreign policy, even though politically it cost him dearly. He privately backed the destroyer deal. Now, remember, this was in the middle of the campaign. And he publicly supported passage of the draft, much to the anger and dismay of GOP leaders. After he lost in November 1940, Willkie went on the radio to announce to the American people, "We have elected Franklin Roosevelt president. He is your president. He is my president. We will support him," which is exactly what he did. Just a few months later, again to the fury of the Republican old guard, Willkie endorsed the legislation creating Lend-Lease. Roosevelt would later describe Willkie as a godsend to this country when we needed him most. The president also acknowledged that Willkie's support for Lend-Lease and the draft, both of which were crucial in winning the war, might well have made the difference between victory and defeat in the passage of those bills in Congress. Before I close, I'd like to talk about another citizens group. Now, this one is on the isolationist side. And that is America First, which was the most vocal and effective isolationist organization in the country. The story of America First and how it was created was, for me, one of the most interesting and surprising things I learned in all my research for the book. Now, when most people think of America First, those who know about America First, I think they think of it as the embodiment of conservative Midwestern isolationism. Actually, it was born on the campus of Yale University, the brainchild of a group of top campus leaders, most of whom were moderate to liberal. The founders of America First included Gerald Ford, future president of the United States, Potter Stewart, future Supreme Court justice, Sergeant Shriver, future first head of the Peace Corps, and Kingman Brewster, future president of Yale, and a little bit ironically, future U.S. ambassador to Great Britain. Three examples of America First supporters at that time included a Harvard senior named John F. Kennedy, a Cornell University student named Kurt Vonnegut, and a precocious student at Phillips Exeter named Gore Vidal, who founded a chapter of America First at his prep school. Today, World War II is known as the Good War, a necessary conflict to save Western civilization from the evil of Nazi Germany and Germany's allies. And that is absolutely true. But in the years leading up to Pearl Harbor, the extent of that evil was not as obvious as it is now. And millions of American college students, who would be among the first to fight, revolted against the very thought of U.S. participation in another bloody European war. To my mind, it was very much like the 1960s in Vietnam. Shortly after America First was organized, it moved its headquarters to Chicago. And from then on, most of its leaders would be Midwestern businessmen, whose social and political views were considerably more conservative than those of its young founders. By the time of Pearl Harbor, most of the Yalees who had founded America First had drifted away from the organization. And when the United States finally entered the war, they, along with the vast majority of other college anti-war activists, immediately enlisted in the fight. The creation of America First, and the way it was done, underlines one of the most interesting aspects of this time in our country, how so many ordinary Americans got involved in this debate and actually had an effect on its outcome. As I said before, millions of people were drawn into the fight, which for all its bitterness and all its anger was a real exercise in democracy. In talking about this, I'm reminded of what President Obama said a couple of weeks ago to Israeli students when he visited Israel. Political leaders will never take risks if the people do not push them to take those risks. And a little later in the speech, he said, ordinary people can accomplish extraordinary things. In the period I write about, ordinary people did accomplish extraordinary things. They had an impact on the president, on foreign policy, and on public opinion. By the time of Pearl Harbor, public attitudes had shifted dramatically. In the beginning, in 1939 and early 1940, the country was largely isolationist. But when the Japanese bombed Pearl Harbor, the American people were now well aware they would have to pay a heavy price if they entered the war. But most of them had come to the conclusion that it was going to be necessary. According to polls in late 1941, a substantial majority of the US population now regarded defeating Nazism as the biggest job facing their country. A similar majority preferred US entry into the war to a German victory over Britain. This psychological and emotional preparation for war was one major reason, in my opinion, for the immediate unity of the country once war was declared against Japan, Germany, and Italy. After all the bitter conflict of the previous 2.5 years, America was finally ready to claim its future. Thank you very much. And I'd be very happy to take any questions that anybody has. Sorry, excuse me.
Other than the Communist Party in the United States, was there a significant change or any change in the isolationist movement after Germany invaded Russia in June of 1941?
Not really in terms of the actual movement. In fact, it kind of reinforced the views of isolationists to a large extent, because many of the isolationists, if not most of them, were very anti-Soviet, Charles Lindbergh being one of them, Senator Burton Wheeler being another. So they didn't want to give any aid to the Soviet Union, to put it mildly, but it did not change their opinion in terms of isolationism in any way. As time went on, isolationists were clearly losing the fight for American public opinion. But they continue to hold out to the bitter end, the major isolationist organization. Yes, ma'am, in the back.
You said that war was declared on Germany. In fact, Germany declared war on the United States.
Well, we eventually did declare war on Germany, but you're right, after Germany declared war on the United States, there was a very long 3-day period after Japan bombed Pearl Harbor. We, of course, immediately declared war on Japan, but did nothing. I mean, the president and Congress did nothing for 3 days about Germany. And so Winston Churchill had a very agonizing 3 days, because if we didn't get into the war against Germany, Britain would be faced to fight on by itself against Germany and Japan. And, it looked like we may not get into the war against Germany. But, of course, Hitler solved that by declaring war on us, and we immediately, the Congress immediately declared war on Germany after that. Yes?
How do the British people and British historians now look back on their country's role in the days leading up to World War II? And I'm in the middle of Madeleine Albright's book, Prague mm-hmm, Winter, mm-hmm. And she really kind of just describes how, the slip-sliding of the British diplomats and British government, and, the Czech people were prepared to fight.
That's right.
And that country was basically handed over to Hitler. And do they appreciate the irony of their own, lack of conviction?
Oh, yeah. No, I think current British historians are not averse at all about writing about that period. I must point out that, in defense of the American people, looking at the way Britain had done nothing, to stand up for the rest of Europe and for Britain and allowing basically Hitler to have his way with Czechoslovakia and then later, you can understand why they would say, you guys, we fought for you in World War I. We fought to make the world safer democracy. And instead, you just, opened the way for Adolf Hitler. And but the current feeling, and certainly among British historians, I mean, it's they're very good about describing that period for the most part. Yes, sir.
So we had this great debate for 2 years, and as you say, and we had a presidential election in the middle of it, in which the choice was not actually posed. Suppose it had been. Suppose the Republicans had nominated an isolationist. What's your view of how the campaign would have progressed and how the history would have been changed?
I'm constantly asked what if questions, and it's very hard to answer them. Certainly Wendell Willkie made it very clear to the U.S. and to the world that regardless of who was elected, American foreign policy was going to be the same. And I think that was extremely important. It was also important in the sense of passing that draft during the campaign and for Roosevelt to sign it. Because if the draft hadn't been passed, the U.S. Army was tiny during this period. And this draft basically added more than 1 million men to the Army's roles. And adding those men to the roles made it possible for us to train an army before we got into the war, before Pearl Harbor, and to actually conduct large-scale maneuvers, before the war. So the Army was still not as good as it should have been, but it certainly was one heck of a lot better than it would have been if the draft hadn't been passed. And so that allowed us, the U.S., to actually go to war in North Africa less than a year after we got into the war, because we had that army, because they had been trained. And that by itself was just an incredibly important example of what Wendell Willkie did. I'm not sure it would have been passed if he hadn't supported it. Yes, sir.
Did your research shed any new light on Father Coughlin and the Catholic Church's role and how Roosevelt used, was it Tommy Corcoran or Attorney General Biddle to shut him up? And did you shed any new light on that issue?
I didn't. I certainly mentioned Father Coughlin in the book and his influence. But I didn't really go deeply into research about him because this book is really broad and probably is too long anyway. I talk about lots and lots and lots of figures. He plays a big role in the when I talk about the right-wing extremist groups and zealots who were fighting Roosevelt, etc. But I don't really go into a lot of detail, and I didn't do really a lot of really deep research on him. He's a fascinating, awful character. There's no question. Yes, ma'am, way back there.
Any research about Lindbergh's visits to Germany?
Yes.
And
yes.
Do you talk about that? Could you tell us a little bit about that?
You're talking about before we
before.
Got into... Yes.
Yeah.
Before the war. Lindbergh left the United States in 1935. This was after his son had been kidnapped and killed. I devote a lot of time to Lindbergh in his early life and how totally unprepared he was to be a celebrity. Somebody wrote in a review on Amazon of my book, and I think it's just a brilliant quote, "No one was less equipped to be Charles Lindbergh than Charles Lindbergh." And it's absolutely true. No one was less equipped to be this, the most famous man on the planet than this guy who didn't like people, who was very reclusive, solitary, hated the press. He just couldn't handle it. I mean, he was totally at sea, really, from the beginning of his fame. And then after, and because he was so basically standoffish, that made the tabloid press and the public more anxious, more eager to know about him. So the pressures were extraordinary on him. And then, of course, came the incredible kidnap and murder of his son. And both he and Anne had had it with the U.S. Charles Lindbergh basically equated his own personal situation with the condition of America. You know, that that he felt that Americans did not respect the law, did not respect the rights of others, particularly including privacy. And so he just decided he had to get away. And so he took Anne and their second son, who had been born a few months after his brother had been kidnapped, took them to stay in England and then in France for several years. And during this period, he was invited by Hermann Göring, the head of the Luftwaffe, to visit Germany, to inspect the German Air Force. And what Göring was hoping for was that Lindbergh would be blown away by the overwhelming power of the Luftwaffe. This was a true propaganda campaign, and it worked. I mean, Lindbergh just thought the Luftwaffe was unbeatable, and that Britain and France had no chance if they ever got into a war. And he said that publicly, and he advised European ally, the Britain and France, basically to give in to Germany, to agree to a negotiated peace. This was before the war began. So it worked. He made several trips to Germany during that time. And this is obviously what caused American people to start thinking differently about Charles Lindbergh. But he still retained that incredible popularity among a lot of people. It's hard to understand why this pilot, because he flew alone across the Atlantic, had such an impact on this country. But you have to remember the 20s was a time of real cynicism and disillusionment and loss of idealism, and there were no heroes. There were no heroes in the 20s. And toward the end of the 20s, people started kind of longing for a hero. And here was this incredibly handsome, smart, unassuming guy that did this amazing thing. And he was our hero and remained our hero for many, many people, really until World War II. Yes?
For years, it's been said Lindbergh was very anti-Semitic. And lately, I've been reading, it's not true. I'd like to know what you think.
Okay. He was anti-Semitic. He made a very notorious speech that many of you probably know about in Des Moines before we got into the war, just right before September 41, in which he said the three main groups that were trying to get us into the war were the Roosevelt administration, the British, and American Jews. And what he was doing is branding Jews as the other, that they were not, that their interests were un-American, that they were, thinking more of being Jewish than American. Well, that was very anti-Semitic. But I hasten to add, and I say this in the book, he was not that much different from many people in this country. His views were very similar to those of a large number of people, from every walk of life, in the State Department, in the War Department, Wall Street, down to the rednecks. There was a very, very deep streak of overt anti-Semitism in this country. What he did was express that in a public speech. I mean, Charles Lindbergh was never very smart politically, I don't think, and that shows. But he was expressing what a number of people were saying behind closed doors. Yes, ma'am.
After all this talk about all these men, were there any women that played a role in this? Where was Eleanor Roosevelt?
I would love to have written about Eleanor Roosevelt during this time. I have written about her in another book, which is not about World War II. Actually, I wrote about her in Citizens of London, my previous book, because she was a very close friend of one of my main characters, John Gilbert Wynant. But she was not involved very much in this period. The woman that I do write a lot about is Anne Lindbergh, because I find her to be such an interesting character. I mean, she was a smart, incredibly talented woman, literary talent. I'm sure some of you have read her books, most especially Gift from the Sea. Her diaries are just wonderful literary creations, but she happened to be born in an age where women's main job was supposed to get married and have a family, and she totally bought into that. And having bought into that, she wanted to marry a hero. That's what she said in high school, I want to marry a hero. She had this romantic idea of Prince Charming who would carry her off, and lo and behold, she married, you know, the biggest Prince Charming in the world. At least that's what people thought. I mean, he was the most eligible bachelor in the world. And her lovely, lovely daydream turned pretty much into a nightmare, at least much of the time. So I find her whole story to be incredibly poignant and really, really interesting. Yes, way back there.
A question about Vice President Henry Wallace. He gets vice president in January of 1941. Mm-hmm. There is in effect a Soviet pact from 1939, and then Hitler attacks Soviets in June 1941. What was his role? Any influence?
I don't know. I write about Henry Wallace, but he was not really a focus. I write about him in terms, actually, of being nominated as vice president in 1940. That's really my focus on Henry Wallace. I don't go into his, you know, his, I mean, a lot of people think that he was more pro-Soviet than he should have been. I didn't get into that. I didn't really do any research on that. I did a lot of research on what effect his nomination made to the party, et cetera, at that time, but I didn't go any further than that. Yes, sir.
Do you talk at all about Joseph Kennedy, the ambassador to Great Britain at the time?
Again, in this book, I do not. I don't deal with him. I did talk about him a fair amount in Citizens of London. The only time I do mention Joe Kennedy is when he went, I have a chapter on movies, American movies, and their effect during that time, you know, when there were quite a few pro-war movies, pro-British movies were made in 1940, 1941, before we got in the war, like Mrs. Miniver, Foreign Correspondent. So I go into great detail on that. And when I do refer to Joe Kennedy, it was when he went, this is in 1940, he was still ambassador to Great Britain, and he went to Hollywood, and as you most of you probably know, he had been a Hollywood mogul himself before this, and he went and had a meeting, a closed-door meeting, with a bunch of studio executives, the heads of studios, and he warned them, most of whom were Jewish, and he warned them not to make war movies because it would bring down on them a big wave of anti-Semitism. So he's basically, you know, It was a very unsavory experience. And unfortunately, a number of them actually took that to heart until a few months later. And then they finally got, they actually did start producing these movies. But that's really the only time I mentioned him in the book. Yes.
What did you find was Roosevelt, if Roosevelt was left to his own designs and didn't have the incredible pressure of isolationism, how would he have gone towards the support of England? In other words, how much of an isolationist was he versus a politician?
He wasn't an isolationist at all. I mean, he really wanted, I mean, he was determined to do as much as he could to save England, but he felt hemmed in by these incredibly strong forces. However, you know, I don't think, quite frankly, that he want, you know, there are a lot of historians that say he was trying to get us into the war very subtly, you know, pushing us along. I actually don't believe he did want to get us into the war, at least in terms of sending troops. There's a lot of evidence to show that, in fact, he was hoping, Roosevelt was always hoping that something would turn up. His wife would talk about that, you know, that something would happen at the last moment that we wouldn't have to go to war. I think he was certainly open to using the Navy, and which he did. I mean, the Navy was engaged really in an undeclared war before Pearl Harbor, and the Air Force to some extent, but he did not want to send an army over there. And some of his cabinet told him, there's no way that you can defeat Nazi Germany unless Americans went over there, which turned out to be true. I mean, there was no way that Germany could be defeated. Britain was, you know, standing there alone, but it was its armed forces were much too small to be able to conquer Nazi Germany, and it was only America that could and did. You know, we've left out the Soviet Union. I haven't talked about the Soviet Union because that isn't the purpose of this book. I mean, obviously, the Soviet Union played an enormous role on the Eastern Front. I do not take anything away from them. But America did actually, as events proved, did need to send an army. Last question. Who hasn't? Let's see. Tina! My goodness.
In your opinion, how real was this threat that Hitler could take over Africa, then get to South America, and then pose this huge threat to America?
That is a very good question. You are the very first person who's asked me that. It wasn't very real at that time. I mean, Hitler really had there were no German plans to do that. Now, what would have happened, you know, if they had been able to conquer England, as they expected to very easily? Who knows? But they certainly didn't have any plans at the time I mean, they really didn't have the army to do that at that time. Again, if they had had all of Europe, if all of Europe had been Nazified, then that might have been different. But certainly not, you know, not as it turned out. There were no plans. And let me just say, to sum up in terms of Churchill, Winston Churchill, I totally agree with Tina. He is the man of the hour, the century, whatever. If he had not rallied his people to stand against Hitler for the time it took for us to get into the war, God only knows what would have happened to the world. I mean, if Britain had gone down, there would have been no beachhead for us to use, you know, to plan the invasion of Europe. Things, I think, would have been very, very different. And for that, we really do have to thank that incredible man. Okay.
Thank you. Just a final thank you to...